So when I first moved to Ottawa, I thought that it was an okay city. But as I've come to live here longer and longer, I've really come to love this city. Oh, just a minute. Do all of you have one reason? Because I'd like you to be able to follow along with us. Also, at the end of the message, we'll kind of have a chat about everything that I've said. So, yeah. So, like I was saying, I've really come to love this city. And I love that the character of our city changes as you move from one neighborhood to the other. I love that there's a ton of green space. I love that the city is clean. I love the diversity and the culture of the city. I love the underground indie music scene. I love the big little city feeling. And I love that it is a relatively safe city. We do live in a safe city compared to some places in the world. I love the fact that history is being made in our city literally every day through innovation or politics or whatever. This is a really cool city to live in. It's a really cool city to raise a family in. I think it's a really cool city to even plant a church. And, but if you were to talk to someone who's originally from Vancouver, or I'm going to make fun of you for just like a minute. I'm not going to make fun of you. But if you were to talk to someone who's from Vancouver or Toronto or Montreal, or pretty much anywhere in the U.S., you'd think that our city is like, is a dump compared to the glorious, gleaming metropolis that they descended from. To be fair, not every interaction with people from Toronto or Montreal is like this, but they tend to be like that. When I first moved here, I heard people saying things like, tell me this sounds familiar, but Ottawa really doesn't have a music scene. Or Ottawa really doesn't have an arts scene. Or there's not really any innovation happening in Ottawa. Or for us cyclists, the cycling scene in Montreal is so much better than it is in Ottawa. Ottawa isn't that multicultural, is it? I mean, the comments about things that Ottawa is not good at, or is not good enough at, went on and on and on. And in fact, in my first 2 years here, because I came from another city that's much bigger than this and much more populated than this, I started to say the same things. And also, it so happened that the first few friends that I made in Ottawa were from Toronto and Montreal. So we kind of said those things a lot. But after a while, I started to find that these comments are not quite true. And after a few more years, I started to notice a pretty disheartening trend in which innovators and leaders and artists from Ottawa were getting overlooked simply because they're from a smaller city. These days it actually bugs me a bit because I have friends who started a country music band. One of them actually helped us out in the beginning stages of Pivot 613. And I think they have really good songs. But in spite of their awesome material, I've watched them fight for recognition simply because they hail from Ottawa. I think it is really weird that people can dismiss you simply based on the place from which you come. And yet the fact of the matter is that if you look at the stories of true disruptors, or people who change the narratives of our social conversations, they come from places you would not expect. And it's true for almost every influential thinker, or leader, or social mover. They come from a town or country or place that is not the supposed hub of influence for the field. And in fact, Jesus was like this. Jesus came from a backwater fishing village called Nazareth in Galilee. And he was dismissed all along the way of his journey. Not just because his message was chaotic and countercultural, but also because of his roots. Nothing good can come from Nazareth. Nothing good can come from Nazareth. And yet the very cornerstone of our historical narrative, the very cornerstone that the Bible poetically says is the cornerstone that the builders rejected, hail from this place and time. And even to this day, people go to great lengths to dismiss Jesus, don't they? Let's check out Jesus in one of his most famous disruptor modes. This happened on a day that we come to call Palm Sunday. Let's read it together, Matthew 21. When they neared Jerusalem, having arrived at Bethpage on Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples with these instructions. Go over to the village across from you. You'll find a donkey tethered there, or colt with her. Untie her and bring her to me. If anyone asks you what you're doing, say, the master needs them. He will send them with you. This is the full story of what was sketched earlier by the prophet. Tell Zion's daughter, look, your king's on his way, poised and ready, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, foal of a pack animal. The disciples went and did exactly what Jesus told them to do. They led the donkey and colt out, laid some of their clothes on them, and Jesus mounted. Nearly all the people in the crowd threw their garments down on the road, giving him a royal welcome. Others cut branches from the trees and threw them down as a welcome mat. Chief crowds went to him, and crowds followed, all of them calling out, Hosanna to David's son! Blessed is he who comes in God's name! Hosanna in highest heaven! As he made his entrance to Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken. Unnerved, people were asking, what's going on here? Who is this? The parade crowd answered, this is the prophet Jesus, the one from Nazareth in Galilee. Pause for a moment right here. Do you see it? Who is this? What's going on here? In fact, if you read the whole chapter, you'll see an interaction he had with some of the people in the city where they ask him directly, show us your credentials. Who authorized you to speak? This was typical big city thinking. This was typical elitist thinking. We have an established pecking order, Jesus. We have an established procedure through which innovation and theological thought comes. You are not it, Jesus. The great disruptor of history, the healer of men, the actual son of David had come to their city and they were dismissive of him. The title, Son of David, was actually a sacred title. It was a legend that they had for thousands of years. According to them, and according to the legend, the Son of David was to be a great, like, militaristic emancipator, not a carpenter from a backwater village. Now, Jesus is actually a descendant of David, but that didn't matter. They were stuck on the fact that he came from Nazareth. And even to this day, if you think about it, Jesus is still a contentious character. Everything about him is unlikely. His origin story is hardly believable. Think about it. There are not many carpenters turned history changers in the human story. And at the core of his teachings, there's something very interesting, very simple, very interesting, very hard to grab a hold of. It is a faith walk that has very little to do with what we can actually work out on our own, but rather a trust that God will work it out in us, if we let him do it. How has history been changed by such a flimsy story? How has history been changed by such a flimsy proposition? So the questions are justified. What's going on here? Who the heck is this? Verse 12, Jesus went straight to the temple and threw everyone out who had set up shop buying and selling. He kicked over the tables of loan sharks and the stalls of dove merchants. And he quoted this text, my house was designated a house of prayer, but you have made it a hangout for thieves. Now there was room for the blind and crippled to get it. They came to Jesus and he healed them. When the religious leaders saw the outrageous things he was doing and heard all the children running and shouting through the temple, Hosanna to David's son! They were up in arms and took him to task. Do you hear what these children are saying? Jesus said, yes, I hear them. And haven't you read in God's word, from the mouths of children and babies are furnished a place of praise. Again, let's pause here for a minute. Can you even imagine what it must have been like for these Jerusalem mockingbirds? I mean, Jesus is a nobody to them. It's a complete nobody. It must have been astonishing that an unrefined, no-name, small-town celebrity from a little city that hardly anybody knows would be causing such commotion. But focusing on the commotion will cause you to miss the point. Focusing on Jesus' origin story will cause you to miss the point. Because once Jesus cleared out the temple, something incredible happened. Even though there's just three sentences dedicated to it, I believe that it is most revealing about the most important thing that Jesus is concerned with. Did you see it? Verse 15, rather at the end of verse 14. At the end of verse 14, now there was room for the blind and crippled to get in. They came to Jesus and healed them. Verse 15, there were children running and shouting through the temple. Somehow, in this metropolis, in this seat of power and religious authority, there was no room for the people that actually needed God to touch their lives. There was room only for the people who could afford it. If you were poor, if you were blind, if you were crippled, or if you were children, there was no room for you in the temple where God apparently was. The temple, which was supposed to be a meeting place between God and his people, in which people could commune with each other and him, had literally been turned into a den of thieves. The act of getting right with God had been turned into a financial transaction that could only happen between pre-approved loan sharks and merchants that the priests had authorized. Last week we talked about the fact that the rules and structures that we set up as a way to gain favor with God will never create in us God's best for us. In many of our lives, we have set up structures and rules like these people who had set up shop in the temple. We've given into arbitrary standards that we think will create God's best in us, and in the process, we've choked out the very thing that has the power to do it. Instead of trusting God's Spirit to do a work in us, we try to force the work to happen, and we live under the crushing weight of unrealistic expectations and standards that God did not impose in the first place. Did God ask them to set up a training floor in the temple? No. In fact, if you look at all the instructions for the temple that God had given them, you will not find a single sentence about the pre-authorized area where the merchants and the loan sharks should sit. Similarly, when God calls you into a relationship with him, what is the one thing he asks of you? Faith. Nothing else. He's done all the rest. And all that he asks is that you just walk towards him and trust his Spirit to work in you. I believe that in our lives, Jesus wants to walk into our carefully constructed temples and lay them to waste. I think he wants to walk into our carefully constructed facades and just break them up. These things, even though they look good and they seem like they're helping us to get God's best in our lives, they're not good, because once they're destroyed, then the real work can start. The healing can start. The freedom can start. Once I was standing on stage and I was leading worship. It was not in this congregation, it was in another congregation. And I saw a kid walk in wearing a baseball cap. It was a kid I'd never seen before. And to make matters worse, he walked in, he walked all the way to the front, and he plopped himself on the front pew. But at this church, we had an unwritten rule that you were not supposed to wear baseball caps to church. Now, the big, fancy, flowery hats that women wear were fine, but the baseball caps, no. You know how the story is going, don't you? An older gentleman who was a keeper of the rules walked up to this kid, and I'm on stage watching this thing happen, and I want to stop the band to say, whoa, but I didn't know whether I should do it or not. Walks up to this kid, yanks off the cap, throws it to the ground, then points his finger in the kid's face and gives him a talking to. We never saw that kid again. Meanwhile, all the pastors of the church got an email from this guy making sure that we make an announcement to tell the whole church that baseball caps are not allowed. Now, this is an easy point to point to and say, don't do that. And indeed, if we're ever blessed to have some teenager, some stranger, walk in here and look nothing like us, I think that that's a pretty easy bar that we shall clear here at Bevan 613. I don't think we're so caught up on outward appearances here. So I think that for us at this congregation, the work is something deeper. I think for us, it is an unspoken measuring stick or an unspoken attitude that needs to be flipped over. And when Jesus walks in into our congregation or into our lives outside this place, I pray that you sit still, you allow him to finish flipping things over, and then you allow the healing to start. Let's read a little bit more, just a little bit more. There's an interesting end to the story. Verse 17. Fed up, Jesus turned on his heel and left the city for Bethany, where he spent the night. Early the next morning, Jesus was returning to the city. He was hungry. Seeing a lone fig tree alongside the road, he approached it, anticipating a breakfast of figs. When he got there, there was nothing but fig leaves. He said, no more fig leaves from this tree ever. The fig tree withered on the spot, a dry state. The disciples saw it happen. They rubbed their eyes saying, didn't we really see this? A leafy tree one minute, a dry state the next. But Jesus was a matter of fact. Yes, and if you embrace this kingdom life and don't doubt God, you'll not only do minor feats like I did with the fig tree, but also triumph over huge obstacles. This mountain, for instance, you'll tell it, go jump in the lake and it will jump. Absolutely everything, ranging from small to large, as you make it a part of your believing prayer, gets included as you lay hold of God. The day before, Jesus was flipping things over in the temple and driving people out. The next morning, he's talking to trees and apparently killing them. What's going on here? I think that what's going on here is a surprising parallel. On the outside, this city looked just like the fig tree. On the outside, the affluence and the stature of the people of Jerusalem looked just like this fig tree. But once you got close up, you realized that things had been destroyed inside by corruption. The word Jerusalem means city of peace. And David had established the city with one person, with one purpose, to be the place where the temple was built and worship of God would happen. David, the warrior king, the worshiping king, had established the city with the sole purpose of prayer and worship. But by the time Jesus arrives, it had been holed up by the greed and corruption of the priestly aristocracy. It was like a fig tree promising fruit, but not delivering. In this moment, Jesus is giving an object lesson about the theme that we talked about last week. And I'd like to extend it to this week. Obsession with outward shows of piety and having your life together creates exactly that. It creates a life that looks pristine on the outside, but is no closer to God's best for you than you were when the pretense started. You see, one of the crucial things about coming to faith in God and coming to this walk with God is the ability to stop the act. If you want to see all this other stuff in verse 22, the major feats that Jesus talks about, if you want to see all of these things, you have to abandon the facade of perfection. You have to stop the struggle to work things out on your own. You have to abandon the things that make us more concerned with outward appearances. And most difficultly, you have to count the things by which you previously defined yourself with as nothing. And for some people, this is a huge ask. It's all tied together, you see. The kind of attitude that would be dismissive of a life change that comes from unexpected places breeds a life that is concerned with outward appearances. And this kind of life misses what is truly awesome about Jesus and the work that he can do in any life. And in our city, and even in cities that look down on us, this is a prevalent attitude. Whether we're clued into it or not, the fact of the matter is that we live in a city in which appearances matter. We live in a city in which appearances matter, and appearances hold a huge sway on the choices that people make for their lives. But I think the lesson for us today, this Palm Sunday, is that we need to check our attitudes. Are we like the people joyfully welcoming Jesus into the city? Or are we like the people who think the city is perfect and doesn't need the disruption of this so-called prophet? To be sure, Jesus will flip things on their head. But what we gain is so much more than what we thought we had by keeping things the way we think they should be. What we gain is a kind of freedom and healing that comes from a place of humility and understanding that God's got it, and all we have to do is trust him. As we shall see next weekend, the very people that dismissed his entry and clamored for his death killed him. But what they meant for evil, God used for good by breaking the curse of sin once and for all. They thought that by killing him, they would silence his followers and his teaching. They really did. God flipped the script. God used his death as the spark to change the lives of billions of people all over history. And even in his death, Jesus was still flipping things over. And this is what makes Jesus so compelling, is that the things that look so innocuous, they're almost laughable, are the very vehicles through which he wants to change things. His is not the flashy, obvious route. His is the subversive, less likely route. And when we stop trying to be the smartest, most accomplished, most pious, most well-dressed people, and we just trash all of those things, we find more than we ever thought we could when we trust him with our lives. So will you trust him today? Will you let him move things around in your life? Will you let him even flip some things over? Will you abandon the facade of perfection and embrace his grace, mercy, and love? Will you? God, take these words and plant them deep somewhere inside us. Amen.